Letters Fyodor Mikhailovich Dostoyevsky to his family and friends. By Fyodor Dostoyevsky. Audiobook 15:18. That is to say, for its God and its faith. This new Russian intelligence is beginning, as it seems to me, to lift its head, and precisely now is its cooperation in the common task essential, and this it is coming, itself, to perceive. Because I preach faith in God and in the people, the gentry here would like to see me disappear from the face of the earth. Because of that chapter in the Karamazovs, of the hallucination, with which you, as a physician, are so pleased, it has already been sought to stamp me as a reactionary and fanatic, who has come to believe in the devil. The gentlemen here, in their simplicity, imagine that the public will cry out with one voice. What? Dostoyevsky has begun to write about the devil now, has he? How obsolete and born he is! But I believe that they will find themselves mistaken. I thank you for having, as a physician, attested for me the authenticity of my description of the psychical sickness of my hero. The opinion of one who is an expert in the matter is very valuable to me. You will, I doubt not, allow that Ivan Karamazov, in the given circumstances, could have had no different hallucination. I mean to give, in the very next number of the diary, some of the critical pronouncements on that particular chapter. With the assurance of my sincere respect, I remain yours most faithfully, Fyodor Dostoyevsky. Recollections of Dostoyevsky by his friends from the reminiscences of D. V. Grigorovich 1837. 1846. It is a mystery to me to this day how I, innately the most extraordinarily nervous and timid of boys, ever got through my first year in the College of Engineering, where one's comrades were far more ruthless and cruel even than one's teachers. Amongst the young men who were admitted to the college after I had been there about a year, was a youth of some 17 summers, of middle height, full figure, blonde hair, and sickly, pale countenance. This youth was Fyodor Mikhailovich Dostoyevsky. He had come from Moscow to Petersburg with his elder brother Michael. The latter did not enter the college, but joined the corps of sappers, and was later sent to Reval on his promotion to commissioned rank. Many years later Michael Dostoyevsky took his discharge, and returned to Petersburg. There he started a cigarette manufactory, but at the same time busied himself in literature, translated Goethe, wrote a comedy, and, after Fyodor's return from banishment, became editor of the Epoch. I made friends with Fyodor Dostoyevsky the very first day that he entered the college. It's half a century ago now, but I can well remember how much more I cared for him than for any of the other friends of my youth. Despite his reticent nature and general lack of frankness and youthful expansion, he appeared to reciprocate my affection. Dostoyevsky always held himself aloof, even then, from others, never took part in his comrades' amusements, and usually sat in a remote corner with a book. His favorite place was a corner in classroom 4. By the window. Out of school hours, he nearly always sat with a book by that window. I had, as a boy, a pliant character, and was easily influenced, thus my relations with Dostoyevsky were those of not merely attachment, but absolute subjection. His influence was extraordinarily beneficial to me. Dostoyevsky was much more advanced in all knowledge than I was, and the extent of his reading amazed me. The many things he told me about the works of writers, whose very names to me were unknown, came as a revelation. Hitherto I had, like the rest of my colleagues, read nothing but textbooks and abstracts of lectures, not only because other books were forbidden in the college, but from lack of interest in literature. The first Russian books with which I made acquaintance I got from Dostoyevsky. They were a translation of Hoffman's Katermer and The Confessions of an English Opium Eater, by Maturin Sick. The latter was especially prized by Dostoyevsky. His literary influence was not confined to me alone, three of my colleagues came equally under his spell. Beketov, Vitkovsky, and Beretsky, in this way a little circle was formed, which gathered round Dostoevsky in every leisure hour. This reading, and the interchange of ideas which it brought about, took from me all inclination for my studies. Nor did Dostoevsky rank among the best pupils. Before the examinations he always made the most tremendous efforts, so as to get into a higher class. But he did not invariably succeed. In one examination he failed entirely, and was unpromoted. This failure worried him so much that he fell ill, and had to go to hospital for a while. In 1844 or 45 I met him quite by chance in the street. He had then completed his studies, and had exchanged military uniform for civilian dress. I clasped him in my arms with cries of joy. Even Dostoevsky seemed glad, but behaved with some reticence. He never was, indeed, given to public displays of emotion. My delight at this unexpected meeting was so great and genuine that it never even occurred to me to feel hurt by his cool behavior. I told him about all my acquaintances in literary circles, about my own literary attempts, and at once invited him to come to my abode and hear my latest production. He willingly agreed. When I had read him my story he seemed pleased with it, but gave me no very extravagant praise. With one passage he found fault. This was how it ran. When the organ stopped, an official threw a copper coin out of his window, which fell at the organ grinder's feet. "No, that's not right," said Dostoevsky, "it is much too dull." The copper coin fell at the organ grinder's feet. You should say, the copper coin fell clinking and hopping at the man's feet. That remark struck me as a revelation. As time went on, I saw more and more of Dostoevsky. At last we decided to set up house together. My mother sent me 50 rubles a month. Dostoevsky got nearly as much from his relatives in Moscow. As things were then, 100 rubles was quite enough for two young fellows, but we did not understand housekeeping, and the money usually lasted us only for the first fortnight. For the rest of the month we fared on rolls and coffee. The house we lived in was at the corner of Vladimir and Grafen streets. It consisted of a kitchen and two rooms, whose three windows looked out on Grafen Street. We had no servants, we made our own tea, and bought all food ourselves. When we set up house, Dostoevsky was working at the translation of Balzac's Eugenie Grandet. Balzac was our favorite writer, we both considered him by far the most important of the French authors. Dostoevsky succeeded, I know not how, in publishing his translation in the Book Lovers' Library. I can still recollect how vexed Dostoevsky was when that number of the magazine reached him. The editor had shortened the novel by a third. But that was what Senkovsky, then the editor of the library, always did with his collaborators' works, and the authors were so glad to see themselves in print that they never protested. My enthusiasm for Dostoevsky was the reason why Belinsky, to whom Nekrasov introduced me, made quite a different impression upon me from what I had expected. Properly tutored by Nekrasov, I regarded the impending visit to Belinsky as a great joy. Long beforehand I rehearsed the words in which I should describe to him my admiration for Balzac. But scarcely had I mentioned that my housemate Dostoevsky, whose name was still unknown to Belinsky, had translated Eugenie Grandet, then Belinsky began to abuse our divinity most terribly. He called him a writer for the bourgeois, and said that there was not a page of Eugenie Grandet without some error in taste. I was so nonplussed that I forgot every word of the beautifully rehearsed speech. Probably I impressed him as a stupid boy who could not say a word in defense of his own opinion. At that time Dostoevsky would spend whole days, and sometimes nights, at his desk. He never said a word about what he was working at. He answered my questions unwillingly and laconically, and I soon ceased to interrogate him, I merely saw countless sheets covered with Dostoyevsky's peculiar writing, every letter as if drawn. I have seen no writing like it, except that of Dumas Père. When Dostoyevsky was not writing, he would sit crouched over a book. For a while he raved about the novels of Sully, particularly the Memoirs des Demons. As a consequence of his hard work and the sedentary life he led, his health was getting worse and worse. Those troubles which had occasionally shown themselves even in his boyhood now became increasingly frequent. Sometimes he would even have a fit on one of our few walks together. Once we chanced to come on a funeral. Dostoyevsky insisted on turning back at once, but he had scarcely gone a few steps when he had such a violent fit that I was obliged to carry him, with the help of some passers-by, into the nearest shop. It was with great difficulty that we restored him to consciousness. Such attacks were usually followed by a state of great depression, which lasted 2 or 3 days. One morning Dostoyevsky called me into his room. He was sitting on the divan which served as bed also, and before him on the little writing table lay a thickish manuscript book, large size, with speckled edges. "Sit down here a while, Grigorovich. I only wrote it out fair yesterday and I want to read it to you, but don't interrupt me," said he, with unusual vivacity. The work which he then read to me at one breath, with no pauses at all, soon afterwards appeared in print under the title of Poor Folk. I always had a very high opinion of Dostoyevsky, his wide reading, his knowledge of literature, his opinions, and the deep seriousness of his character. All extraordinarily impressed me. I often asked myself how it was that, while I had already written and published a good deal, and so could account myself a literary man, Dostoyevsky did not yet share this distinction. But with the first pages of Poor Folk it was borne in on me that this work was incomparably greater than anything that I had so far written. That conviction increased as he read on. I was quite enchanted, and several times longed to clutch and hug him, only that objection of his to effusions of feeling, which I knew so well, restrained me. But I could not possibly sit there in silence, and interrupted him every moment with exclamations of delight. The consequences of that reading are well known. Dostoyevsky has himself related in his diary how I tore the manuscript from him by force, and took it to Nekrasov forthwith. He has indeed out of modesty said nothing of the reading to Nekrasov. I myself read the work aloud. At the last scene, when old Divutchkin takes leave of Veronika, I could no longer control myself, and broke into sobs. I saw that Nekrasov also was weeping. I then pointed out to him that a good deed should never be put off, and that, in spite of the late hour, he should instantly betake himself to Dostoyevsky, to tell him of his success and talk over the details of the novel's appearance in the magazine. Nekrasov too was very much excited, he agreed, and we really did go straight off to Dostoyevsky. I must confess that I had acted rashly. For I knew the character of my housemate, his morbid sensibility and reserve, his shyness. And I ought to have told him all quite quietly next morning, instead of waking him in the middle of the night, and, moreover, bringing a strange man to visit him. Dostoyevsky himself opened the door to our knocking. When he saw me with a stranger, he was frightfully embarrassed, turned pale, and for a long time could make no response to Nekrasov's eulogiums. When our guest had gone, I expected that Dostoyevsky would overwhelm me with reproaches. But that did not happen. He merely shut himself up in his room, and for a long time I heard him walking excitedly up and down. After Dostoyevsky had in this way come to know Nekrasov, and through him Belinsky too, for the latter, also, soon read Poor Folk in manuscript, he was suddenly as if metamorphosed. During the printing of the novel he was continually in a state of the most excessive nervous excitement. His reserve went so far that he never told me a word of what further ensued between him and Nekrasov. I heard indirectly that he exacted from Nekrasov that his novel should be set up in quite peculiar type, and that every page should have a sort of framing. I was not present at the negotiations, and cannot therefore say whether these rumors were founded on truth. One thing I can decidedly say. The success of Poor Folk, and still more the extravagant eulogiums of Belinsky, had a bad influence on Dostoyevsky, who till then had lived wholly shut in with himself and had associated only with people who took no interest at all in literature. How could such a man as he have remained in his normal condition of mind, when at his very first entrance to the literary career, an authority like Belinsky prostrated himself before him, and loudly proclaimed that a new star had arisen in Russian literature? Soon after Poor Folk, Dostoyevsky wrote his novel M.R. Prokhartchin, which likewise was read aloud to Nekrasov. I was invited to the reading. Belinsky sat opposite the author, listened greedily to every word, and now and then expressed his delight, saying over and over again that nobody but Dostoyevsky was capable of such psychological subtleties. But perhaps Belinsky's enthusiasm had less effect on him than the subsequent complete revulsion in Belinsky's appreciation and that of his circle. About that time Belinsky said in a letter to Anenkov, Dostoyevsky's Mistress of the Inn is terrible stuff. He has attempted a combination of Mariinsky and Hoffman, with a dash of Gogol. He has written other novels besides, but every new work of his is a new calamity. In the provinces they can't stand him at all, and in Petersburg even Poor Folk is abused. I tremble at the thought that I shall have to read this novel once more. We've been well taken in by our gifted Dostoyevsky. So Belinsky wrote, the most honest man in the world, and he meant every word of it most honestly and thoroughly. Belinsky never flinched from declaring his opinion of Dostoyevsky, and all his circle echoed him. The unexpected transition from idolization of the author of Poor Folk to complete denial of his literary talent might well have crushed even a less sensitive and ambitious writer than Dostoyevsky. Thenceforth he avoided all those who were connected with Belinsky's circle, and became more reserved and irritable than ever. At a meeting with Turgenev, who likewise belonged to Belinsky's set, Dostoyevsky unhappily lost control of himself, and all the anger which had gathered in him flamed forth. He said that he was not afraid of any one of them, and would tread them all into the mud in time. I forget what was the immediate cause of the outbreak. I think they were speaking of Gogol, among others. But in any case I am convinced that Dostoyevsky was to blame. Turgenev was never given to quarreling, he might rather be reproached with too great pliancy and gentleness of character. After the scene with Turgenev it came to an open breach between Dostoyevsky and the Belinsky set. Now they overwhelmed him with derision and biting epigrams, and he was accused of monstrous conceit. They said too that he was jealous of Gogol, whom in justice he should adore, since on every page of Poor Folk the influence of Gogol was unmistakable. This last reproach, if it is a reproach for a novice, was not quite unjustified. Old Divutchkin in Poor Folk does undoubtedly recall Poprishtchin the functionary, in the Memoirs of a Madman of Gogol, in the scene where Divutchkin loses a button in the presence of his superiors and, much embarrassed, tries to pick it up. One cannot but think of that scene of Gogol's where Poprishtchin tries to pick up the handkerchief which his superior's daughter has dropped, and comes to grief on the parquet floor. Not only the constant use of the same word over and over again, but the whole composition, betrays Gogol's influence. Once, I forget why, he and I fell out. The consequence was that we decided to give up living together. But we parted on good terms. Later I often met him with acquaintances, and we treated one another as old friends. From the Reminiscences of A. P. Milyukov 1848. 1849 I made Dostoyevsky's acquaintance in the winter of 1848. That was a momentous period for enthusiastic and cultured youth. After the February Revolution in Paris, the reforms of Pius IX, the risings in Milan, Venice, and Naples, the victory of liberal ideas in Germany and the revolutions of Berlin and Vienna, everyone believed in the renaissance of the whole European world. The rotted pillars of reaction were crumbling one after the other, and all over Europe new life seemed to be in bud. Yet in Russia, at that time, prevailed the most crushing reaction. Science, no less than the press, could hardly breathe beneath the heavy yoke of the administration, and every sign of mental vitality was stifled. From abroad, a quantity of liberal writings, partly scientific, partly literary, were smuggled into the country. In the French and German papers, people, despite the censorship, were reading stirring articles, but among ourselves all scientific and literary activity was rendered well-nigh impossible, and the censorship tore each new book to pieces. Naturally, all this had a highly exciting effect upon the younger generation, who on the one hand were, through these foreign books and journals, making acquaintance not only with liberal ideas, but with the most extreme socialist doctrine, and on the other, were finding that the 256 most harmless notions of liberalism were relentlessly persecuted in their own country. They would read the flaming speeches made in the French Chamber and at Frankfurt, and at the same time see how, among ourselves, someone was punished like a criminal every day for an incautious word or a forbidden book. Almost every foreign post brought news of fresh rights gained for themselves by the people, while in Russian society one heard only of fresh special decrees and persecutions. All who remember that time will know the effect this had upon the younger generation. There now began to form, in Petersburg, little groups of young men, who for the most part had but recently left the high schools. These assembled solely to discuss the latest news and rumors, and to express opinions freely. In these groups, new acquaintances were made, and old ones renewed. I happened in this way to be present at an assembly which took place at the abode of the young writer A. N. Plekshaev. I there entered into relations with a set of men whose memories I shall ever cherish. Among others were present Porfiry Lomansky, Sergei Durov, Nikolai Monbelai and Alexander Palm, both of whom were officers of the Guards, and the brothers Michael and Fyodor Dostoyevsky. All these young men were extraordinarily sympathetic to me. I became particularly intimate with the two Dostoyevskys and Monbelai. The latter then lived in barracks, and we used to assemble at his quarters too. I made further acquaintances among his circle, and learnt that large assemblies took place at the abode of one M. V. Budakevich Petrakevsky, whereat speeches on political and social questions were made. Someone offered to take me to Petrakevsky, but I declined, not from timidity or indifference, but because Petrakevsky, whose acquaintance I had recently made, had not particularly attracted me. He held quite two paradoxical opinions, and showed a certain aversion for all things Russian. On the contrary, I very willingly accepted an invitation to enter the little group which gathered about Durov. He attracted many who belonged also to Petrakevsky's set, but embraced more moderate opinions. Durov lived at that time with Palm in Gorokhovoye Street. At his small abode there assembled every Friday an organized circle of young men, among whom the military element was represented. As the host was of modest means, and the guests always remained until 3 o'clock in the morning, each had to pay a monthly contribution towards the entertainment, and the hire of a piano. I attended these evenings regularly, until in consequence of the arrest of Petrakevsky and the members of his circle, they were suspended. Dostoyevsky also frequented these evenings at Durov's. Our circle occupied itself with no revolutionary plans of any kind, and had no written statutes at all. In short, it could not possibly be described as a secret society. We assembled to exchange the then proscribed books, and to discuss questions which were not permitted to be openly touched on. Most of all were we interested in the question of the emancipation of the peasants, and at our meetings we always spoke of the ways and means to this reform. Some thought that in view of the reaction which had been brought about in our country by the European revolutions, the government would never decide to carry out the emancipation of the peasants, and that it would come rather from below than from above. Others, on the contrary, maintained that our people had no desire whatever to follow in the footsteps of the European revolutionaries, and would patiently await the decision of their fate by the government. In this sense, Fyodor Dostoevsky expressed himself with particular emphasis. When anybody in his vicinity declared that the emancipation of the peasants by the lawful path was most doubtful, he would retort that he believed in no other path. We talked too of literature, but chiefly with reference to remarkable newspaper articles. Occasionally the older writers were discussed, and very severe, one-sided, and mistaken judgments often found expression. Once when the subject happened to be Dershaven, and somebody declared that he was much more of a turgid and servile ode maker and courtier than the great poet for which his contemporaries and the schools had taken him, Dostoevsky sprang up as if stung by a wasp, and cried, "What? No poetic rapture, no true ardor, in Dershaven? His not the loftiest poetry." And forthwith he declaimed from memory a poem of Dershaven's with such power, with such ardor, that the singer of Catherine the Great rose at once in our estimation. Another time he delivered some poems of Pushkin and Victor Hugo, similar in subject, and proved to us, with great success, that our poet was a much more remarkable artist than the Frenchman. Durov's circle included many fervent socialists. Intoxicated by the utopias of certain foreign theorists, they saw in this doctrine the dawn of a new religion, which one day should remodel the world on the basis of a new social order. Everything that appeared in French on the question was discussed hot-foot by us. We were always talking about the utopias of Robert Owen and Cabet, but still more, perhaps, of Fourier's phalanstery, and Proudhon's theory of progressive taxation. We all took an equal interest in the socialists, but many refused to believe in the possibility of practically realizing their teachings. Among these latter was, again, Dostoevsky. He read all the works on socialism, it is true, but remained wholly skeptical. Though he granted that all these doctrines were founded on noble ideals, he nevertheless regarded the socialists as honest, but foolish, visionaries. He would say again and again that none of these theories could have any real meaning for us, and that we must find our material for the development of Russian society not in the doctrines of foreign socialists, but in the life and customs, sanctified by centuries of use, of our own people, in whom had long been apparent far more enduring and normal conceptions than were to be found in all the utopias of Saint Simon. To him, he would say, life in a commune or in a phalanstery would seem much more terrible than in a Siberian prison. I need not say that our socialists stuck to their opinions. All new laws and other actions of the government were also discussed and severely criticized by us. In view of the arbitrary rule which prevailed in our country, and the grand events which were coming off in Western Europe, and inspiring us with the hope of a better and freer mode of existence, our discontent is wholly comprehensible. In this respect, Dostoevsky showed the same zeal and the same rebellious spirit as the other members of our circle. I cannot now remember the actual content of his speeches, but I do recollect that he ever protested against all measures which in any way implied the oppression of the people, and was especially infuriated by those abuses from which the lowest ranks of society and the students equally suffered. One could always recognize the author of Poor Folk in his judgments. One of us proposed that discourses should be held in our assemblies, each was to write an indictment of the government, and read it aloud to the rest. Dostoevsky approved this plan, and promised to do something of the kind. I forget whether he carried out his promise. The first discourse, which was given by one of the officers, dealt with an anecdote which was at that time common talk. Dostoevsky found fault both with the subject and the form of this effort. On one of the evenings, I read a passage from Lamennais Paroles d'un Croyant, which I had translated into Church Russian. Dostoevsky assured me that the grave biblical language of my translation sounded much more impressive than that of the original. Later on, we resolved to print several copies of some of our members' papers, and circulate them widely, but this plan was never carried out, for just then the majority of our friends, and those in particular who had attended the Petrikevsky evenings, were arrested. Shortly before the breakup of the Durov Circle, one of its members had been in Moscow, and had brought from there a transcript of the famous letter which Belinsky had written to Gogol in the course of his correspondence with friends. Fyodor Dostoevsky read this letter aloud both in our circle and in the houses of several of his friends, and also gave it to different people to be transcribed anew. This was subsequently the main pretext for his arrest and banishment. Belinsky's letter, in its paradoxical one-sidedness, would scarcely impress anyone much at this time of day, but it then produced a remarkable effect upon all minds. Along with this letter, there was then circulating in our set a humorous article by Alexander Herzen, similarly brought from Moscow, in which our two capitals were contrasted no less wittily than maliciously. On the arrest of the Petrikevsky group, I know that numerous copies of these two works were seized. Besides our evenings for discussion and reading, we had musical ones. At our last assembly, a very gifted pianist played Rossini's overture to William Tell. On April 23, 1849, I heard, through Michael Dostoevsky, of the arrest of his brother Fyodor, as well as of Durov, Monbeli, Filipov, and others. A fortnight later, I was told one morning that Michael Dostoevsky also had been arrested the night before. His wife and children were left wholly without means of support, for he had no regular income whatever, and lived entirely by his literary work. As I knew the tranquil and reserved character of Michael Dostoevsky, I was really but little concerned as to his fate. It is true that he had frequented Petrikevsky, but he had been in disagreement with most members of the circle. So far as I knew, there could be little against him. Therefore I hoped that he would soon be set at liberty. As a matter of fact, he was, at the end of May, and came to me, early in the morning, to look up his son Fedyaev, whom I had housed. In the evening of the same day he gave me many particulars of his arrest, of his stay in the fortress, and of the questions which had been put to him by the Committee of Investigation. From these questions we could gather what would be the indictment against Fyodor. Although he was charged only with some rash utterances against high personages and with the dissemination of proscribed writings, and the momentous Belinsky letter, these things could, with ill will, be given a very serious turn. In that case, a grievous fate awaited him. True, that gradually many of those arrested were being set free, but it was said that many were threatened with banishment. The summer of 1849 was a sad time for all of us. I saw Michael Dostoevsky every week. The news about our incarcerated friends was very vague, we knew only that they were all in good health. The investigating committee had now ended its labors, and we daily expected the decision. But the autumn went by, and not until shortly before Christmas was the fate of the prisoners made known. To our utter amazement and horror, they were all condemned to death. The sentence was not, however, as all the world knows, executed. Capital punishment was at the last moment altered to other penalties. Fyodor Dostoevsky got 4 years hard labor in Siberia, and after completion of that sentence was to be enrolled as a private in one of the Siberian regiments of the line. All this was done so hastily and suddenly that neither I nor his brother could be present at the proclamation of the sentence on Semyonovsky Square. We heard of the fate of our friends only when all was at an end, and they had been taken back to the Petropavlovsky fortress, except Petrikevsky, who was sent straight from the tribunal to Siberia. The prisoners were dispatched in parties of 2 and 3 from the fortress to their exile. On the third day after the sentence, Michael Dostoevsky told me that his brother was to depart that very evening, and that he wanted to go and say goodbye to him at the fortress. I too wished to say goodbye to Fyodor Dostoevsky. Audiobook generated by Read with the Ears.